Hello and welcome to another MindBreeze tutorial. Today we will look at how to configure the Microsoft SharePoint connector for on-premise installations. This will include a short introduction, the prerequisites, and the index config, as well as looking at how to analyze the crawl documents and the crawl runs. The connector supports Microsoft SharePoint versions 2007 and later, as well as supporting Kerberos, NTLM, Basic, and ADFS authentication methods. To see the exact prerequisites and preparations required for the SharePoint server itself, please take a look at help.mindbreeze.com. Please also ensure that the created crawling user has full read access on all SharePoint applications which should be crawled. As a best practice, it is recommended to use the resolution caches available to you out of the box, the LDAP cache and the SharePoint Principal cache. We will take a look at configuring the caches in more detail a bit later. Using ACL references is not required for the standard configurations and should not be used unless advised. Using track document URL changes is also recommended, so that duplicate items are not indexed when the URL of a document changes. Resolving SharePoint groups is only required if no SharePoint principal cache is configured. However, the use of the cache is strongly recommended. Therefore, this option in the best case should not be used. Normalize ACLs is only required if an LDAP cache is not configured. This is deprecated as using an LDAP cache is now the recommended approach. Next, we can see the metadata extracted by default by the connector. Pay special attention to the SP underscore property name. This means per default, MindBreeze will extract every SharePoint property attached to a SharePoint document. This includes, for example, the author, the version, content tags, and very many more. In the following tables, you will see the default metadata extracted for the various content types. Feel free to pause the video now and for the next four slides to take a look at the included metadata per content type. Here you can see the metadata which is automatically extracted for blog posts, posts, Wikipedia pages, and items. Next, you can see what is exactly extracted for folders, discussions, and replies. Finally, you can see the large amount of automatically extracted metadata for user profiles. Now let's take a look at how to configure the SharePoint on-prem connector and the caches directly. Let's log into the Management Center and navigate to the Configuration section. The first thing we will do is configure the crawling user credentials for SharePoint. To do this, we need to navigate to the Network tab and then click on Add Credential. Let's create a new credential of type Username Password and give it a unique name and add the credential details. Adding a credential object is advantageous because the credentials are encrypted and admin users who configure services using these credentials, such as crawlers or caches, do not need to know the sensitive passwords themselves. They can simply select the configured credential from a drop-down menu. The next task is to add an endpoint for our SharePoint server. This maps the configured credential to the SharePoint server URL. To do this, we will click on Add Endpoint, add the root URL of the SharePoint server, and then select our credential from the drop-down menu. Finally, we will scroll up and configure an LDAP server. We can add multiple servers here if we wish, and unless specifically disabled, MindBreeze will perform automatic LDAP server discovery. Now that we have finished all of the networking prerequisites, let's take a closer look at the different caches available to us. So, why do we need to use caches in the first place? Quite simply, they help to reduce the amount of load on the target systems in a controllable way. Calls are not made to the source system to, for example, resolve ACLs, rather to a cache on the MindBreeze appliance. Now let's take a look at each cache in more detail and how they interact. At the highest level, we have the LDAP cache. This caches users and groups directly from the Active Directory. Next, we have the SharePoint cache. In addition to the LDAP principal tree, the SharePoint cache adds SharePoint principles to this. After this point, we can see on the left-hand side how this information from the cache is delivered back to the client service, where a specific user is searching over the index. The client service will deliver the username along with the user query to the query service, and the query service will then call the SharePoint cache to resolve the user's groups and permissions. To configure these caches, we need to add them as services found at the bottom of the Indices tab. Let's first configure an LDAP cache by adding a new caching LDAP principal resolution service. Let's give the cache an appropriate name and then add the LDAP server hostname. Now, let's add the credential we configured previously using the drop-down menu. Finally, at the very bottom, we can configure the web service port on which this LDAP service will run. We must ensure that this is always a free port unused by any other service. We will leave this one as the default 23900 for now. Now, let's set up a SharePoint principal cache by adding a new service. The config is similar to the LDAP cache as before. We will need to choose an appropriate name, add the SharePoint server URL, what is new, however, is that we need to point the SharePoint principal cache towards our configured LDAP cache. We can do this in the LDAP settings config section and inputting the port number of our LDAP service, 23900. Additionally, we should ensure that the option Use LDAP Cache is enabled. When we define the port for this service, we should make sure it is not the same as any other service. In this case, we will choose 23901. Now let's save and restart and take a look at how we can debug and more precisely control our caches via the included API. You can access the API endpoint of any cache via your appliance URL 8443/cache/port-number/control. To send requests to this endpoint, we need to send the action parameter along with the appropriate value. For example, we can force a cache update with action equals update cache, or we can download a specific principal using the action check principles and then supplying the individual ID parameter along with a username. Let's take a look at this now with the user David Porter. Here, we can see the full principal stored in our LDAP cache for this user directly in the browser in a readable format. If we change the port number to 23901, we can see the same user, but now in our SharePoint principles cache, so we can now view, for example, the SharePoint groups he belongs to. Let's have a look at how we can configure a SharePoint index and crawler which can take advantage of these caches. Firstly, let's add a new index with a SharePoint connector, and then give our index an appropriate name, and scroll down to the Data Sources section. To configure the connector, firstly, we need to name the category instance. This can be thought of as an internal ID of the crawler and should be unique when combined with the category, if no intersection of data is desired. Next, we will add the data source name. This is how the data source will be named on the front end. Underneath the source name, we must also remember to add the caching principal resolution service. Firstly, we need to add the SharePoint server URL. This should be the same as we have configured for our SharePoint caches and our endpoints in the network tab. As we have configured our credentials and endpoints already, we can leave the account and password sections empty. We will leave use claims on auto. This is best practice as the SharePoint connector will try to use ADFS authentication, and if this is not possible, it will then fall back to other authentication methods. So MindBreeze will decide on the best method to authenticate. Now, let's scroll down to the site restriction section. Here, we can configure exactly which site should be crawled. If we wish, we can supply the path to a CSV file containing a list of all sites we want to crawl. If we don't supply a file here, site discovery will be performed, where the crawler will attempt to automatically find all sites from a specific SharePoint server. Additionally, if using site discovery, we can configure include and exclude CSV files to control which of the discovered sites should be crawled. If we look below this, we can see the crawl URL section. Here, we can define regular expressions to include or exclude specific URLs. We can also define whether user profiles should be crawled or not with the crawl user profile option. As previously discussed, it is best practice to have the use ACL references option disabled. We can track document URL changes to ensure that duplicate documents with differing URLs are not indexed. We can use the following options for more control on SharePoint groups and ACLs. Resolving groups means that the SharePoint group members will be resolved during crawl time and stored on the document, and normalizing ACLs will convert the AD users and groups to the distinguished name format at crawl time. These are not necessary for us as we have configured our caches. Now, because we have finished with the config, let's save and restart. Because of our configured rules, we currently cannot save this config, as it is attached to a client service which has no authentication method. We can stop this error by enabling the unrestricted public access option. If we keep the enforce ACL evaluation option enabled, we will be able to save but won't be able to view any of the documents in the search client without first logging in as an authenticated user. MindBreeze will then evaluate the ACLs of each document against this authenticated user. Now, let's take a look at our crawl run in AppTelemetry. Tip: for more information about how to use AppTelemetry, please have a look at our AppTelemetry tutorial video. Let's first navigate to Reporting, Telemetry Details, and then open the crawler logs, View Telemetry Data. If we organize the logs by start time, we can see our most recent logs at the top. We can now right-click on the category column and add a new filter to view only logs where category contains Microsoft SharePoint. Let's add another filter in the same way for the operations column, so we only view logs for crawled documents. If we select one of these rows in our log pool of crawled documents, we can then view the associated requests tab in the pane below. This shows us all services used during the ingestion of this document in MindBreeze during the indexing process, including the filter service, the index service, and the crawler service. This is incredibly handy as we are now able to view all of these services and their logs in the context of one document, and we can view the status of this document at each stage in the pipeline, all in one location. Now, let's take a look at a whole crawl run in AppTelemetry. If we again open AppTelemetry and then navigate to Applications, Crawler Service, View Telemetry Details, we can then see the same data as before. Now, let's sort by time, add a filter on the Operations column so that it will only show us operations of type crawl run. Let's click on one of these results now and take a look at the details which appear below. Here, we can see in-depth information about this specific crawl run, including timeline data, crawl run statistics, and more.